Hello everyone. Narcissist Free almost here, and today I'm bringing Spiral Down part 2 of 2. In part 1, I described my situation and how this would eat away at one's confidence and self-esteem. This ambient abuse and abuse by proxy will leave you in a chronic state of self-doubt without you knowing how you even got there. And yes, this is all done on purpose, by the narcissist, to make you pliable, suggestible, and easily manipulated. Keep in mind, narcissists are sadistic, and also obtain supply by simply duping their victims, and then watching and absorbing the energy of their pain. Over time, if they can break you down to the point of helplessness, because you'll be seeking some sort of relief, you'll inevitably become agreeable to just about anything. The point of all of this is to keep you useful, to train you to uphold the illusion they've created, to do their every bidding and make them feel powerful, and to continue the lies by your fear of their retaliation. In other words, become and remain their puppet. This is what they want, right? I mean, why work so hard to get you there if this isn't the end goal? Well, it is and it isn't, because once you've bended, or even break to their will, they will hate you for it. So, it doesn't matter what you do, or how much you give them their way. They will never be happy, they are insatiable. Why would they hate you when they are getting their way? Because now they will see you as weak, thus even more deserving of the abuse they met out. Quite the paradox, isn't it? Well, it isn't really when you understand that the malignant narcissist lives in destruction. Recall the Freud's drives or instincts. Eros being life, and Thanatos being the death drive. Our natural state should be Eros, one would think. But the narcissist chooses the later, hate, destruction, envy, greed and so on. Ultimately, once they can no longer destroy others, they will destroy themselves. Unfortunately for us others, there's plenty of us around for them to destroy. Anyway, these disturbed characters despise weakness, and they will perceive your cooperation as such. Also, things like trying to keep the peace, gratitude, and charity, etc. If these sound like high-level, healthy defense psychological defense mechanisms, and good personality traits, they are. The narcissist will imitate these for supply, but secretly they despise them. In their minds, only they should be receiving kudos for being generous, and only they should be on the receiving end of charity, compliments, invitations, and gift-giving. They are special in their minds and should be recognized as such. Of course, they soak up all the doting, but as an intimate other you'll be accused of faking your kindness, and this interaction is known as projection. Narcissists are brilliant projection machines. And what most people here already know is that if you listen carefully when the narcissist speaks, especially when they are raging, they are always telling on themselves. Unless you've experienced this, a normal person cannot even begin to wrap their head around this type of behavior, and is one of the reasons it's so hard to explain and believe. If you're unfortunate enough to have been entangled with a narcissist, you're damned if you do and damned if you don't, a classic double bind. However, if you're lucky enough to get away from them, you can watch with amusement how they create their own double binds to live in. Sadly, it is these constant double binds that will lead a normal person into a state of learned helplessness, and eventual insanity. So, how did we get to that place? The answer to that lies in our own defense mechanisms and how they were used against us. To review briefly, a defense mechanism, or strategies, are in place to protect the mind, self, and ego from a situation where a person cannot cope. More than likely, when you met the narcissist, you were functioning at a mature and healthy range of defenses, such as sublimation, assertiveness, flexibility, altruism, anticipation, humor, introjection, and thought suppression. Here, keep two things in mind. 1. Narcissists exploit anything and anyone they come in contact with, especially your emotions, and 2. The narcissist is actually functioning at the lowest level, and what are called infantile defense mechanisms. Of course you won't know this because they wear their mask of normality and maturity so well, having filed away all the right emotions, for all the right occasions. When the mask does slip, you'll get the feeling that something is off about the person, and you'll be very tempted to let it slide, giving them the benefit of the doubt. But there will also be a general feeling of irritation, and or confusion, that should tip you off that something is very, very wrong. Trust your gut, and then become vigilant. Now, here we are working unconsciously, continually arranging and rearranging strategies to deal with the narcissist. Their antics certainly leave you feeling mentally and emotionally exhausted. As a result, without even realizing it, your healthy, mature defenses start to break down, making you resort to lower level ones. Over time, and I know this is true for me, you begin matching the narcissist. For example, you start engaging in yelling matches to defend yourself against their rages, where you never would have ever thought you'd be capable of such a thing. In other words, reactive abuse. You don't feel good about it, and you can't believe you've even lowered yourself to such behavior. However, this is the narcissist's fuel, and they're loving every minute of your distress, while you're berating yourself for behaving badly. Make no mistake, you are being deliberately brought to this state. The narcissist must feel good about themselves by crushing you, and further fuel is gained by using all of your reactions against you at a future date. See why no contact is so important. You can never win. Stay with a malignant narcissist too long and you'll be living in states of dissociation, projection, splitting, reaction formation, acting out, denial, fantasy, passive aggression, hypochondriasis, isolation, rationalization, regression, and repression. And this will feel horrible. And you know you don't want to do these things, but you will feel compelled. This is when self-loathing steps in. In case you're wondering, this is where the narcissist lives, and having broken you down to their level, they can say, "See, it's them, not me," forever playing the victim. Now, from what we've learned in object relations, if you are matured emotionally, it's really not possible to stay at these immature defense mechanisms where the narcissist is doomed to remain. And that's really good news. If you recall, looking at the developmental paranoid schizoid position, the infant cycles through with projection and introjection to bring together both good and bad aspects of an object. Once this position is worked through, we come to the depressive position, at about 6 months of age, where the child begins to see others as whole objects and not part objects. This integration opens up a whole new world of experience. It is here the child realizes that his mother has a life of her own, separate from himself. And this is where anxiety comes in, as well as jealousies. With this new perception of mother and others, concern grows, and the child begins to inhibit some of his aggressive tendencies so as not to destroy a loved object. Survival of the self and dependency is felt, so annihilating the loved object when angry cannot be an option. Failure to fully work through this position leads to rigid black and white thinking, splitting, projection, etc., and this is where I believe the narcissist lives. Again, failure to work through this fundamental developmental task in infancy thus leads to the nightmare cluster B personality disorders most of us here have unfortunately experienced. Now, what does this have to do with our own healing? To get back on track here. The fact that we have developed normally means we cannot live in the depressive position. I would guess that everyone here has at least successfully developed past the emotional age of 2. I hope. Understanding that yes, defense mechanisms are strategies to help one cope, and that while you have had to resort to more or less mature defenses to cope, you cannot erase the growth you made previous to the narcissist. Once you remove yourself from the toxic environment, you will not only return to your normal ways of being, you will have been reluctantly propelled into much greater personal growth and awareness. Meanwhile, you leave the narcissist where they are, that is, trapped in an early infantile mental and emotional state. For whatever reason they are there, no one can make them change or grow up. It's very rare that a narcissist sees the light and changes their entire personality. They do not have the capacity to grow, and hell, ask most of them and they don't want to change. On the other hand, Like it or not, the narcissist has catapulted you into a massive growth spurt. You've become aware of the painful feelings of self-hate, and even your own unhealthy coping strategies. Also, as you start to see light at the end of the tunnel, you might even start appreciating yourself and what you've been through much more. At least I hope that's the case for you. I called this two-parter Spiral Down, because that's exactly what has happened. Having been entangled with a tragically immature individual, you now know the wrong person can take you down to their infantile emotional level, and not only keep you there, but enjoy watching your destruction as they do it. The edge the narcissist had over you was your maturity, your reasoning abilities, your open and honest communication, etc. You, in essence, told them how to hurt you, if that makes sense. The spiral down was first about using your mature strategies to initially cope, and as the narcissist discovered your vulnerabilities by watching and listening to what bothers you, they begin the deliberate dismantling of those, without you realizing it, because keep in mind, these are mostly unconscious. As the confusion begins, because of the narcissist's pathological lying, and the anxiety ramps up, because the narcissist is constantly poking at your boundaries, you will become fatigued and irritated, and your mind will search for other ways to cope, which will becomes the gradual decline into immature defenses. This does not feel good, and it's so gradual you will hardly notice. Your confidence and self-esteem will start to fade. Self-doubt sets in, and you start leaning on the narcissist for reality checks and reassurance, exactly how they planned it. But now you know, your defense mechanisms are fluid and reversible. That's the good news. You know now, where you were before the narcissist is not only possible, it's probable. Not only that, because of this experience you will, if you want to, become a much more whole, integrated, wise, and wonderful person. And the narcissist stays exactly the same, right where you left them. So what you know for sure now, is that you fell back on earlier defenses in order to cope with the abuse, and it will be entirely likely that you will not only survive this, but become an amazing human being because of it. The narcissist forced us to become conscious and aware, and in the end that is all to our benefit. And you better believe, the narcissist is absolutely envious of this. Hell, they were envious because we were so together when we met them. That's why they picked us. Am I right? With time, and time is the big one here, extreme self-care, education, and validation, you will begin your spiral up and out of the fog. A word of caution though, if you're tempted to rub it in the narcissist's face, don't. Be aware that any hint of getting healthy opens you up to the narcissist sabotage, something I'm all too familiar with. You being happy and doing well without them only triggers their envy. Stay gray rock. Better yet, stay no contact. Well, that's it for now, and I do hope that helped someone today. Remember to like and subscribe and comment. Feel free to follow me on Facebook at Narcissist Free Almost, and Instagram at Clumber_Lover with a U. And as always, love to all. And I hope you're enjoying peace of mind living narcissist free. I know I am.